Hello and welcome to the Art of Being Human. On the last segment, I started talking about eating disorders, and I'm going to continue with that today. It's a very interesting subject because we all have to eat, and because we all have to eat, we could be prone for developing an eating disorder. Although many of us don't have the eating disorders, and we eat normally, and when we're finished and we're full, then we just go on to something else. But some people are obsessed by food because you have to eat 3 times a day, sometimes more, sometimes less, and so therefore they get obsessed by food. Well, I want to go into, and I've told you before, of course, that eating is a combination of getting nutrition and following society and what society expects of us as people who take in nutrition. So the first condition, I'm going to call it a condition, is anorexia nervosa. We've all heard of it. Anorexia nervosa is a morbid fear of obesity, and it's a distortion of body image. You can, and I've counseled people who have anorexia, and they'll look at themselves in the mirror, and they may be as thin as a pencil. 60 pounds, 70 pounds, 80 pounds, as adults, we're not talking about children here. And they still think they're so heavy, they don't see themselves as they are. They look in a mirror, they're extremely thin, they look at themselves as being very, very heavy set. And they'll say, well, if I just exercise a little more, if I just lose another 5 pounds, I'll be better off. I can barely see them, they're so thin. But they think of themselves as being very heavy. So they do not have a good representation of themselves. When they look in a mirror, they don't see themselves as they are. They have a preoccupation with food. They refuse to eat, but they suffer from hunger. People used to think that they never get hungry. Well, they do. They get very hungry, but they refuse to eat. They figure if they take 100 calories or 200 calories in, then their hunger will stop. They're obsessed with losing weight to the point that even if they're hungry, they don't want to eat. They won't satisfy their hunger. Now, sometimes they will eat and they'll eat a lot, but when they do, they just throw it up because they want to get rid of it. They had to eat in order to satisfy their hunger, and then they threw it up because they didn't want to have any weight on. People achieve weight loss in a different number of ways. There's a reduction of food. There's extreme exercising. If you've dealt with anorexics, they are exercising all the time. They're walking all the time. They're biking all the time. They're just overdoing with the exercise. They vomit. They use laxatives and they use diuretics, anything to get the calories out of their system. They have an obsession with food, and yet at the same time, they'll hoard food, they'll conceal food, they'll prepare elaborate meals because they're starving. They want to eat, and then when they eat, they throw it up so they won't keep it. And in that way, they cause a lot of medical problems. Now, I have to tell you that I have counseled a number of people with eating disorders. And I won't counsel them unless I'm working also with their doctors because this disease is dangerous. People do die of it, and because they can get to the point where their body does not know how to digest food. Just imagine if you refuse to eat and you refuse to eat and you look like like you've just come out of a concentration camp. It's like your stomach doesn't know how to digest food anymore. It's like it's lost the ability to know what to do. So when you feed it just you don't digest right because the stomach can't figure out how to do it. And there are a lot of very, very bad illnesses that occur. You destroy your stomach, you destroy your esophagus, you destroy your mouth and all of your teeth because with the continual throwing up, the acids just destroy anything. You get burned from all of the acids. You can eventually get cancer from it. All of the natural things that go on in the mouth and the esophagus are destroyed because you're constantly throwing up. And at that point, you see the acids acids of your stomach are destroying the parts of the stomach where the acid should not be. And the esophagus and the mouth are involved. The teeth get bad because of the fact that they can't, that the acids wear away the teeth, the enamel of the teeth. So it's very, very serious. You can get terrible illnesses from this. And so when I see a person, and I know for sure that they're anorexic, oh, they have some other eating disorder, not just anorexia, but anorexia is what a lot of people have. I have them sign a statement, and I call the doctor, and I work with the doctor. If they won't allow me to work with the doctor, then I won't see them. I'll refer them somewhere else. And I think most counselors feel the same way. If they're going to work with a person with an eating disorder, they need a medical backup. Because you don't know what's going to happen. You can get into a medical crisis fairly easily, and you have to have that medical backup. Now, they may resist it, but I'm straight out with them. If I can't talk to your doctor, you'll have to go somewhere else. Because I need to have that medical backup to make sure that I can give them the right kind of care. Now, I want to go into bulimia nervosa. Oh, by the way, anorexia usually starts in more common in girls than boys, and usually starts around the preteen years, sometimes earlier. And it kind of is a problem that they have for the rest of their lives because it's hard to end it. You know, it's hard to say I'm not going to be anorexic anymore because the temptation is always there to look thinner and thinner. And the fact is they don't see themselves as they are. They can be thin and see themselves as heavy. So you can't really teach them, you know, that if you see yourself as thin, that's the way you are. If you see yourself as heavy, well, it doesn't mean that you're heavy because you think you are. How do you get rid of some concept like that? It's a difficult therapeutic thing. Now, there is such a thing as bulimia nervosa, and that's binge eating. It's compulsive, rapid eating of large amounts of food, usually high-calorie foods, ice cream, puddings, usually soft foods, and ice cream and puddings would be soft cereals and so forth. And also, these foods are usually sweet. And sometimes they're not even chewed. Sometimes the food goes in the mouth and you just swallow it. The binging may occur in secret, and then the food is purged by vomiting. So it's just as bad as anorexia, but instead of, with anorexics, you will shy away from food, you don't want to have it. Bulimics will have it and then get rid of it, and they will have large amounts of it. There's also a misuse of laxatives and diuretics, and some people binge and then they have anorexic behavior, binge and purge alternately. It's just really a terrible mix-up. Now, there is a combination called bulimorexia. Bulimorexia is a combination of anorexia and bulimia. First, starving yourself, then overeating, then starving yourself, then overeating. Can you think about what kind of a quandary that puts the body in? How the body has to react in terms of the nervous system, the stomach, the digestive system, and the glandular system, how that all has to react to either too much food, not enough food, no balance, getting rid of food. It's very, very hard for a human body to adapt. The human body is always under stress. And that's the reason why I always insist on medical backup. If I see a person, because if I'm going to counsel them, I have to make sure that if there's a medical crisis, the person will be seen and it'll be treated. Also, I have them go to a doctor for weight checks. Nobody wants to have their weight checked. Oh, it's too heavy or it's too thin, you know, and they don't want to have their weight checked. It's people don't like to have that done, and I wouldn't want to do it in a counseling office because you want to develop trust and you want to develop confidence and all those things that are important to have counseling succeed. But the doctor would do it. They would put them on a scale and they would weigh them and see if they'd lost or if they'd gained. A half a pound gain is good, a half a pound loss is bad. And so it has to be done from a medical perspective. Now, the health problems of eating disorders can include the following: dehydration, electrical imbalances in the body, imbalances in terms of the chemicals that you have, gastric acid problems, and which affect the teeth and the esophagus. But you also have mood disorders, depression, anxiety, and drug use. I can remember a girl walking in my office. She was so thin. I mean, she was so tiny. Her bones, you could practically see her bones. And I said, is there a problem with your eating? Do you have a problem maybe having an eating disorder? And so I approached it gently because she didn't want to talk about that. She came for something else. But a lot of times when people get into counseling, they don't present with what's really wrong. They may want to handle what's really wrong, but they're embarrassed to talk about it. So therefore, they talk about something else. And you have to gently lead them to what you know is wrong. And even if I know what's wrong, I can't necessarily tell them. I do at some point, but not when they're beginning counseling, because they need to develop a trust in me, and they need to allow them to develop a trust in me before I just go digging or telling them this, that, and the other that they may be sensitive to. But at any rate, you do get mood disorders and depression and anxiety and drug use. And so I talked to this girl, and I said, you seem to be very thin. Is there a reason for that? She says, well, she had a rare illness that causes her arms and legs to be thin. Now, I knew that wasn't the case. In my gut, I know, you get to trust your gut. She just wasn't eating enough. And I says, well, have you ever seen a doctor to see if you could maybe gain a little weight because you look too thin? Oh, no, he understands that I have this condition, so he doesn't bother me about it. Well, if a patient refuses treatment, that's their right to refuse treatment. And she may have gone to a doctor, and he may have mentioned it, and she may say, well, I really don't want to deal with that. I've got this other problem. And he may just have taken her lead. You know, who knows what it was? I don't know what it was. Now, the causes of eating disorders, there are some theories as to why people develop eating disorders. One is that there may be a hereditary disposition, and there may well be. I can't prove it, but I can't prove it's not there either. And so it could be hereditary because it occurs more in families. It's more common in sisters and mothers than it is in brothers, sons, and fathers. So it seems to be more a female kind of thing than a male kind of thing. It could be due to an endocrine problem, and that an endocrine problem, which would be a problem with the hormones, would develop after months of not eating right. You would expect to have an endocrine problem. The question is, do you put the cart before the horse, and which comes first? You know, did the endocrine problem cause the anorexia, or bulimia, whichever it is, or is it the other way around? Did the anorexia or bulimia cause the problem with the glandula? So we don't always know. And then there could be neurochemical problems as well that could cause it. I've already talked to you about the hypothalamus. Sometimes it gets out of sync, and the person just never feels full, and they keep eating because they're not full. And that's true more in terms of obesity. Now, it can be a control issue. Some people feel like they're over controlled by their spouses, by their friends, by their families, by the schools, and they want to gain control. And how do they do it? They gain control by deciding what goes into their bodies for food and what does not go into their bodies for food. And they feel they more in control if they decide that they're not going to eat. Why? Because, you know, if I don't eat, you can't force it. You can't force me to eat if I don't want to eat, especially if I'm an adult. So therefore, I've got more control over my body and over my situations if I decide not to eat and you can't do anything about it. In various parts of my life, you may have control over me, and I'm using me as just, you know, it doesn't affect me personally, but just as an example. I might say, my husband controls me, my kids control me, my job controls me. I feel out of control. I can't take that. I've got to get some control back. So what do I do? I'm going to control the amount of food that I eat or the amount of food that I don't eat. And for the most part, it's going to be don't eat, because everyone expects you to eat, everybody wants you to eat, and that feels like they even have control of that. So if I feel they have control because they want me to eat and they're telling me to eat, and I want to resist their control, I'll simply have my own control. I won't eat. And they can't force me. And so therefore, that's the way that I have control. That's a very prevalent feeling for those that I've counseled that have anorexia. They feel that they are out of control, that people are controlling them, so they're just not going to eat. The problem is it becomes, after a while, kind of addictive, and then they start misperceiving their body. The body gets out of sync, and they start misperceiving it, and they get so tied in with food and how not to eat it that they look at themselves and they misperceive their size. They look at themselves, well, I'm heavy, I'm not going to eat. I'm hungry, but I'm heavy. If I do eat, I'm going to get rid of it. You know, because I'm not going to let food stay in my system and make me fatter than I already am. And so it goes along like that. And then what I do in counseling, I try to reverse it. You are in control if you eat. You're out of control if you don't eat. Now, sometimes it works. Sometimes it doesn't. But you have to work with them in a very careful plan, because they will resist gaining weight no matter what you do. And here is where you need your medical backup. Now, so it's important that you understand the control issue. There is also another issue, and that's the fact that we expect people, teenagers, to be perfect. Now, I'm not saying we really expect that, but that's the perception that they have. Their parents are at them because their grades aren't high enough. You mean you only got a B and you could have had an A? You know, something like that. So the parents are at them for high grades and doing everything right, and they feel like they have to do everything right. So if there's anything wrong, then they feel they're to blame, and they have to punish themselves, and they have to make themselves perfect. Well, what would be more perfect than being thin? How could a parent complain because you're thin and you're beautiful? They would be more likely to complain if you're heavier. And so therefore, it becomes an issue of, I have to lose weight so that I can be perfect in my parents' eyes and also in my friends' eyes. Oh, isn't she beautiful? Because she's thin. Models are thin. Models are ridiculously thin. But they're thin. I think in France now there's a rule that you can't have a model that's too thin, because they're all becoming anorexic so they could keep their jobs, because the perception of beauty was that your models are thin, and that's part of their beauty, is the fact that they're thin. But they were becoming anorexic and they were becoming sick. So I think the French government passed a law that you could not hire a model that was too thin. They would have to be a certain weight that would be healthy for them before they could actually be hired as a model. I don't know if you remember the model Twiggy. Twiggy was a French model. This is years and years ago. She was so tiny. She was so thin. I think she's still alive. I think she has a business somewhere. But at the time that she was modeling, she was very, very, very thin. So the idea of perfection for teenagers, which is important to them, and you have to understand that, is be as thin as you can. The problem is there are health risks, and then you go right into an anorexic situation. So there are social issues involved. Now, obesity, and I'll try to finish up with this, is excessive body weight. And it may be due to physical conditions, because of the hypothalamus not regulating the hunger, so that they always feel hungry. And I've mentioned before some of my friends who always had to eat because they were always hungry. They never could shut it off because they were always hungry. You don't want to go through your day. What do you do if you feel hungry? Well, you look for a snack. That's the first thing you do. And usually after you had the snack, you feel fine again. Okay, now I'm full. But these people are never full, and so they keep eating and eating and eating. You know, and this is a, it's a hard thing to have. It's difficult to handle because they have to lose weight, but they have to eat to survive. So how do you eat in such a way that you lose weight and at the same time you survive, but you're not getting too thin? And if you eat, you make sure you're not getting too heavy. This is what various organizations help with, you know, Weight Watchers and organizations like that. I had a friend who had an organization called Your Way, and it was to treat people, help to treat people who had problems with eating, and most of them were too heavy and they wanted to be thinner. Issues concerning obesity, and I'll just read through this. It can be caused by genetic influence. There may be hypothalamic problem, as I mentioned before. They may have had past experiences that caused them to be that way, because, so it's kind of like an emotional trauma. They may have ego development problems where the ego is development is not complete. They may have dependency issues. They may have marital issues. They may have control issues within the family, which I've already touched on. And they may have conditions like hypothyroidism or diabetes, and that causes weight changes. And so you could have a real medical condition that affects it. There are other host of psychological problems you can have. It's hard to treat because you have to eat, you know. It's not like an alcoholic. Stop drinking, you're not gonna kill yourself if you stop drinking because your body doesn't need the alcohol. But unless you're addicted, but you can still get off from it. But you can't get off from food completely, so everything you eat is either gonna be disgusting to you or you're gonna want more. So restoring nutritional health is always an immediate concern. You have emaciation, dehydration, electrolyte imbalances, and all of this can cause death. And some people die of heart attacks. One thing I'd like to have you realize, for anorexia, a lot of people die from anorexia, and what they die of is actually heart attacks. I had a friend of mine who had anorexia, and I worked with her some, and I worked with her, and there were other people that worked with her. She finally died of a heart attack. You get the electrolytes in your body so off balance that your body can't function. And when that happens, your heart can skip beats, it can change its beat patterns, and eventually it just may stop. So a lot of people with eating disorders, and I'm not talking so much about obesity, I am talking about anorexia, bulimia, bulimiorexia, they can get and die of a heart attack because their bodies are just so out of sync, and their bodies can't digest food because they've gone so long without it that they can't figure out, the body just can't figure out what to do. They've lost the ability to digest. So it's a long, long road to getting well, but some people do get well, and if you have it, don't give up. You can get well too, but you've got to have medical help and you need psychological services to be able to do that. So I'm going to close it here. We have no time left, and we'll be dealing with something else next time. Please join me then.